I'm Shayna Galen, and this week I'm going to be talking to you a bit about gentlemen's clubs during the Regency era. If you're not sure what the Regency era is, go ahead and look at some of my other videos where I discuss the Regency era and how the Regency got its name and so on. So, gentlemen's clubs. Basically, anyone who was someone during the Regency, any man who was a gentleman or peer was going to belong to a gentleman's club. And these clubs had subscription fees, and they also had elections. So if someone wanted to be a member, they had to be supported by a member already, and then the other members voted on whether or not to admit that member. And so there was some difficulty in being accepted. The oldest club, and probably the most prestigious of them, is White's. And it was founded in 1693. It was more conservative-leaning, so it had mostly Tory members. And it was founded on the site of a coffee shop or a chocolate shop in 1693. The sort of club that opposed that one was Brooks's, and it was a more liberal-leaning club. So you had a lot of members there who were in the Whig Party. And another very prestigious club was Bootle's. That was probably second only to White's in how prestigious it was, and it's also the second oldest club in England, remaining in England. And there were others, like Waiters is another popular one, and that one was sort of dedicated to fine dining. Most of the clubs served dinner. They had a lot of gambling. Bootle's was very well known for its extensive gambling. They might have a reading room. They might have a bedroom for someone who was traveling from out of town and needed somewhere to stay. So they kind of provided a bastion of maleness for gentlemen who wanted to be with other men or just wanted to have somewhere to go to get away from their wives and children, I suppose. Most of the clubs were located in the St. James's area, sometimes right across the street from each other. And this area was known as more of a male part of town, and so most of the time, respectable women were not seen in that area after dark. Okay, so there were other clubs as well besides these, a lot of those are not around anymore. You can go to St. James's now, and you can walk by White's and Brooks and Bootle's and see those clubs. They don't give tours. They don't allow anyone to come in, but you can certainly look outside and take pictures and wonder what old Duke or gentleman might be inside reading the papers or what have you. But there were other clubs as well, and these were often catered to people who had certain interests. And one of the clubs was the Guards Club, which was founded in 1810 by the Duke of Wellington and the Prince Regent. And it was a military club that was located across from White's and generally was for officers of the military. There were other clubs like that. I mean, maybe for somebody who, like, there was the Four in Hand Club for people who are horse enthusiasts. There was there were clubs for people who like to travel. So all sorts of different clubs. But the Guards Club is what inspired my gentleman's club in the Survivor series, which was called the Draven Club, and it's named after Lieutenant Colonel Draven, who was the head of the troop, sort of the special ops troop that was formed out of 30 younger sons of the nobility who are the best and the brightest at what they do, also expendable because they're younger sons. And they fought against Napoleon. Only 12 of them came back, and when they came back, they all kind of wanted a place where they could go to hang out together, lick their wounds, what have you. And so they started the Draven Club. And so I give a little bit of a description of the Draven Club and Third Sons of Charm. And this is from Ewan's point of view, and I'm going to read a bit to you. It starts off, he's arriving at the club, and he's met by the master of the house. And the master of the house's name is Porter. And he is sort of kind of a butler kind of guy who is oversees everything. And at the Draven Club, they have, a billiards room, they have a reading room, they have a dining room. It's not so much for betting, so they don't really have that, but they have all sorts of different rooms. And Ewan's hungry, so he wants to go to the dining room. So here's a little part of that. This is from chapter one. It's from chapter one or chapter two, I can't remember. Although he could have found his way with his eyes closed, Ewan followed Porter through the wood-paneled vestibule lit with a large chandelier. A suit of armor stood on one wall and two Scottish broadswords on the opposite. The place looked like the sort of establishment Henry VIII would have frequented. But the object that always drew his attention also made him more than a little melancholy. It was a large shield mounted on the wall opposite the door. A big medieval sword cut the shield in half. The pommel of the sword had been fashioned into what Neil had once told him were fleur-de-lis. A skeleton stared at him from the crossguard. Around the shield were small fleur-de-lis that marked the fallen members of the survivors, those who hadn't made it back from the war. The shield reminded Ewan that his lost friends were here in spirit. Still following Porter, who only had one leg, Ewan was forced to move slowly. Porter's wooden peg thumped on the polished wood floors as he led Ewan past the winding staircase carpeted in royal blue and into a well-appointed dining room. Like the entryway, the dining room was paneled in wood. The ceiling was low and whitewashed, crossed by thick wooden beams. Sconces lined two walls and a fire burned in the mammoth hearth. Four round tables covered with white linen and set with silver had been placed throughout the room. At a fifth table, Neil Raxall, a.k.a. the Warrior, sat with a glass of red wine centered before him. Neil liked order. He liked both giving orders and order in his life. He dined at the club 4 days a week precisely at noon. He always sat at the same table and in the same chair. No one else ever dared sit in that chair if there was a remote possibility Neil might drop by the club. And if he came unexpectedly, the man in the chair vacated it without being asked. They'd all served under Major Roxall long enough to know that while he could be flexible when the situation called for it, he preferred routine and predictability. Neil looked up when Ewan entered. Porter paused, waiting for a sign from the de facto leader of Draven's troop. When Raxall flicked his gaze to the empty chair at his right, Porter led Ewan to it and pulled it out. He sat. "Wine, sir?" Porter asked. Ewan nodded. "And would you like dinner, Mr. Mostyn?" He looked at the man as though he'd asked Ewan if he wanted to be run through with a bayonet. "Very good, then. I will bring the first course. Mr. Raxall, more wine?" Porter inquired. The warrior looked at Ewan. "Will I need it?" And that is a little bit of a description of how I see the Draven Club. And so that's a bit about gentlemen's clubs for you. I don't have an idea for what I'm going to talk about next week. So if you do have an idea, I'd love for you to post it in the comments. I don't have a giveaway this week, but maybe you have a suggestion for a giveaway too. So please post ideas in the comments, suggestions for topics. What do you want to hear about? And I will see you soon. Thanks.